Well, good morning to you all.
Good morning.
Good to see you here today, and any of your visitors, you're especially welcome. And today, at the conclusion of our service, we'll be celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And we invite anyone who know the Lord and worship him and seek to live for him to join with us as we share communion at the end of the service. Just a few announcements before we worship together. Just to say that our midweek prayer meeting continues via Zoom. That's on Wednesday at 7:30. Although Bible class has been able to continue via Zoom, we haven't been able to have the children in for Sunday school. And we're still not allowed to have Sunday school in its traditional form. But what we can do after recent easing of restrictions is that we can have a children's ministry meeting while we are worshipping here in the church. It has to be at the same time rather than before the service. So I've been liaising with the elders and Rona and her team, and they're basically getting geared up to start a Sunday children's ministry in the hall. This is for all the children who would normally come to Sunday school. And we're meeting together in the main hall. I know that she's already been in contact with some of the parents, and probably just a few more to make contact with this week. So really, it's an opportunity to get our children back, if not into normal Sunday school, at least some form of ministry to them, because it's really been too long since we've had them in our hall. So Rona has asked me to announce this today, and if you have any queries, please speak to her. But the plan is for the children's ministry meeting to start on Sunday the 16th. That's a fortnight from now, and that would be from 10:30 a.m. so that parents can drop their children off and then come in to church. And just a few practical notes in terms of what the parents have to know. Children have to bring their workbook, which they will have received recently, a pencil, a pen, and a Bible. Parents are to drop the children off via the front hall door and leave at the sidewalk door and collect the children in the same way. Only one family in the porch at the drop-off and collection times, and we'd appreciate if this was done swiftly and safely. Creche toys are not permitted, therefore parents should bring their own if they feel they will need them if they're going to take their little ones out. The plan is to use the Gorton Glush Hall, the smaller hall, as a creche. Children must be registered by parents weekly, and note, no snacks are permitted for children or parents. So I hope that gives a good overview of what we're hoping to do, and we are very excited at the opportunity now to welcome our children back on a Sunday. And we hope this will be the first step towards eventually seeing Sunday school and Bible class meeting in our hall. So please remember that in your prayers. Of course, we have come to worship God today, and I just want us just to think in these few verses from Psalm 18 as we just focus our minds on God and why we're here today. Psalm 18, verse 1. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I am saved from my enemies. This is the God that we've come to worship today, the God who has done so much for us. And especially today, as we share in communion, we remember of the amazing grace he has shown us in the gift of his son, Jesus, who was prepared to go to the cross at Calvary and die there in our place so that we might be saved from our greatest enemy, sin and death itself. Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Loving Father, as we bow before you today, we thank you that you are here by your Spirit. And we thank you, Lord, that throughout this past week, we have known your presence through different situations that we have faced. And Lord, these continue to be challenging times for many people. But we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to your people and your faithfulness to your word, that you will never leave us nor forsake us, regardless of what the circumstances, issues, or problems may be. And we thank you, Lord, that whenever we are struggling to cope, Lord, you draw alongside us by your Spirit to encourage us, to enable us to keep going. And we thank you, Lord, for that spirit of perseverance that took your son Jesus to the cross. We think of the time he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and it was a real struggle. But he chose your way, the way of the cross. And Father, we could never thank you enough for that. Because that choice that he made has made all the difference for this world. And we thank you, Lord, that as the disciples, after Jesus returned to heaven, as they went out with the gospel, many heard and believed. And that message continues to be proclaimed today, even this morning, right across this world. The message of hope that only Christ can bring. And so we praise you, Lord, for all you have done through him and all that you continue to do through him as you move by your Spirit in our lives and in our church. So, Father, enable us to give full attention to you during this time, that we would give of ourselves in worship, but we would be ready to receive all that you would say to us through your word, and how you would minister to us later as we share in the elements of bread and wine. So we thank you and praise you for this day, for this time. We commit ourselves and this time to you and pray that Jesus, our Savior, will be glorified all we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to commence our service by singing the modern version of Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Lord, I take refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bows, they set their arrows against the strings, to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple, the Lord is on his heavenly throne. He observes the sons of men, his eyes examine them. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked and those who love violence, his soul hates. On the wicked, he will rain fiery coals and burning sulphur. A scorching wind will be their lot. For the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. Upright men will see his face. Amen.
Thank you, Catherine. We're going to continue to worship God now as we sing our next hymn, Speak, O Lord. Life seems to be full of tests. We can all remember the tests that we did at primary school. And then there was more advanced examinations that we faced when we went to big school and beyond. And other tests we must face in life include driving tests, eye tests. When we go to our GP, he or she may do some tests, medical tests, checking our blood pressure, blood sugar, or cholesterol levels. Some of us may have to attend hospital outpatients appointments to have tests performed by specialists. And last year we became aware of the swab tests that check for the COVID-19 infection. But there are other tests that come our way. Situations that test our patience. Circumstances that test our resolve. Events that test our faith. So many tests that that we have to face. And this has led some people to conclude that life is a test. In fact, Winston Churchill, who rallied our nation during the Second World War, said, "Life is a test, and this world a place of trial." And I don't think any of us could argue with that. Given the choice, I'd hazard a guess that none of us enjoy being tested. And of course, the events of this past 13 months have been testing. And sadly, this time of testing will continue for many in our world. But there are times in life when testing can be for our benefit. Take an electrical appliance or a motor car, for instance. If such devices are not tested thoroughly, then the end user will be in danger of injury, of losing their life. Psalm 11 is all about tests. That's why you perhaps don't hear many people refer to it as their favourite psalm. And yet, it contains an important and perhaps a timely message for us. It focuses on two things: the people who are tested and the God who can be trusted. The writer is David, but we can't be sure what the circumstances were at the time he wrote these words. Some Bible scholars think this psalm belongs to the time when David was in Saul's palace, when he was loved by many, but feared by the jealous king who was intent on killing him. Others believe that the psalm refers to the days immediately prior to David's son Absalom rebelling, when the conspiracy against David was growing stronger and it seemed wise for him to escape. We can't be sure of the exact background to this psalm, but the situation described in it could correspond with either of those I've just mentioned. What we can be sure of is this: whatever the circumstances, David was putting his trust firmly in God. In verse 1, he says, "In the Lord I take refuge. How then can you say to me, 'Flee like a bird to your mountain?'" Right from the off, David is nailing his colours to the mast. Whoever his adversary may be at this time, David knows that the only one who can offer him protection is the Lord himself. And I'm sure many of us will admit that there are times in life when we're struggling and we don't go to God for advice. We don't go to him for the wisdom and assurance we need, but rather we look to ourselves, or maybe we look to others for their advice. And no doubt many of us could also say from experience that sometimes those situations didn't end well, unless of course we realized that we needed to go to God before it was too late. And maybe those times when we failed to trust God from the beginning have maybe served to teach us a valuable lesson, namely that he should be our first port of call. If David was here today, I imagine he would warn us against trusting in people or things that ultimately cannot save us. Because he says as much in Psalm 146, where he wrote, "Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing." Whatever trials we're facing, like David, we need to look to the God who can be trusted. In this psalm, David is responding to friends or advisors, referred to as miserable comforters by some commentators, with reference to Job's so-called comforters. And here in the opening verses, we see David rebuffing them as he says, "How then can you say to me, 'Flee like a bird to your mountain?' For look, the wicked bend their bows. They set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do?" Those who are seeking to advise David, they may be genuine in their concern for his safety. But in a sense here, I think we can detect that they're actually mocking David for his faith in God, as they paint a picture of hopelessness, which is actually of no help to him at all. And we may actually see a connection here with personal experience that we've had. Whenever others have tried to steer us away from what we believe God is wanting us to do in a particular situation. And the reason, of course, is that those friends or acquaintances are not looking at the situation from a faith-based perspective. And this reminds me of the time when Peter rejected Jesus' statement that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer and die and be raised on the third day. And Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." There's no question that the wicked can pose a real threat to the righteous. So there is some truth in David's counselor's statement that the wicked bend their bows, they set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. David's enemies were out to get him. And our enemy, Satan, will do all he can, including using other people to get at us, seeking to undermine us, discourage us, dishearten us, and ultimately destroy us. That's the devil's aim. So in the words of 1 Peter 5, verse 8, we need to be self-controlled and alert because our enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. I think we all know the importance of foundations when it comes to the stability of buildings. But a strong foundation for your life and mine is even more important. And Jesus told a story about two builders to make that point. With the builder who built on the rock being the wiser of the two. And the rock, of course, is Jesus. So when David's friends started talking about foundations being destroyed, David knew, and we should be assured, that the foundations that God provides can never be destroyed. Yes, the foundations on which we build our lives may be severely shaken, but because God is committed to preserving the righteous, those who have put their trust in him, those foundations can never be destroyed. There are two foundations that guarantee that we can survive the storms and stand strong. The foundations of God's church here on earth and the foundation of his rule in heaven. And this is what David is referring to here in verse 4. If God's church and his heavenly rule were somehow destroyed, where would the righteous be? Where could they stand? In 1 Timothy 3 verse 15, the church is described as the pillar and foundation of truth. The truth. If it doesn't stand for what's right, what recourse does God's righteous people then have? God's rule in heaven provides the ultimate foundation for the preservation of truth in the world. If God does not rule over all powers, then truth will never stand. But the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne, says David. A man who was a believer lost his job because of his Christian integrity. He refused to sell used goods as if they were new. And having gone through such an unjust treatment, it seemed as if the foundations of his life had been shaken. And they had been. But those foundations were not destroyed. In the end, the man ended up with a much better job. Furthermore, in his new job, he was given the freedom to share his faith with others. Now, of course, standing up for what we believe and striving to live by our faith won't always improve our situation. But the fact that we take a stand that's based on our belief in a God of authority, it will be seen by him and by others. And ultimately, our faithfulness will be rewarded, if not in this life, in the next. Having focused on the God who can be trusted, David then turns his attention to the people who are tested. Reading from the middle of verse 4, we're told that the Lord observes the sons of men. His eyes examine them. The Lord examines the righteous. That's how the NIV Bible translates it. But if you look at the Old and New King James versions, you'll see that the word for examines is translated as trieth or tests. Whether it's examines, trieth or tests, we can be sure that we are all under the watchful eye of God. We are under his scrutiny. And there are many passages of scripture that indicate that this is the case. For example, in the well-known Psalm 139, David says to God, "You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways." The writer of the book of Proverbs tells us that a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord, and he ponders all his paths. They also tells us that the eyes of the Lord are everywhere, keeping watch on the wicked and the good. In Luke 12, verse 2, Jesus says to his disciples, "Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whatever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you whispered in private rooms shall be proclaimed on the mountaintops, on the housetops." We are all under observation. I'm sure, like Gillian and I, many of you like to watch TV crime dramas. And there's one we just started watching recently. And no, I'm not talking about Call of Duty. No, this particular drama is centered on a police surveillance officer who has been tasked with watching a suspect from a house across the street. This officer has all the gear, the top-of-the-range camera, the high-definition telescope, and high-spec computer equipment. So he can record every detail of the suspect's movements and report the details to his boss. He has everything he needs to complete the mission. But in the first episode, he makes a mistake. He leaves his post, with the result that he misses the sighting of a person of interest that almost costs him his job and may still have major ramifications for him. I wonder, as God watches us, does he ever leave his post? No, of course not. And we know this because the scriptures tell us that he who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. These verses from Psalm 121 reveal another aspect of God's watching us. See, some people see God as a kind of a schoolmaster who is waiting for us to mess up so he can punish us. And although there will be times that God will test us to see how we respond, he is always watching over us. This compassionate aspect of God's attention is also expressed in Psalm 32, where it says, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you." In the fifth verse of Psalm 11, there is a distinction between the righteous and the wicked. David says, "The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked and those who love violence, his soul hates." So the first thing to notice here is that the righteous will be tested. The righteous will be tested by God. A parent begins the process of teaching their son or daughter to ride a bicycle. From the beginning, they are testing their child. First, they test that the child can reach the pedals with their feet. Then they want to be sure that the child can balance with the aid of stabilizers. And when these are removed, they'll run alongside the child, keeping one hand on the back of the saddle until they're sure that the child can manage without assistance. The whole process is designed to put the one whom the parent loves to the test. The purpose of this test is to train the child so that she or he can experience the exhilaration of riding a bike unaided. It's the kind of test you want because of where it leads. God gives this kind of test to the believer throughout their life. No matter how severe the testing may be for you or I, it's important to realize that the one who allows it is the one who loves you and wants the best for you. The next thing to notice in verse 5 is that the wicked are hated by God. The wicked are hated by God. The testing of the righteous stands in sharp contrast with the Lord's hatred of the wicked and those who love violence. Now, this isn't a wild, out of control kind of hatred, but a just, appropriate, and righteous response to evil in the world. And if we are truly God's people, we will respond in a similar way to the atrocities and acts of violence that we see in our TV screens or read about in our papers. The final two verses of the psalm spell out the results of God's testing the wicked. The wicked will be punished by him. In verse 6, David says, "On the wicked he will rain fiery coals and burning sulfur. A scorching wind will be their lot." Now the imagery here is dramatic, referring to raining fire and sulfur. And centuries earlier, God had done exactly that in his wrath against Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord rained fire and sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah because of their inhabitants' wickedness. Now, there's some debate among scholars as to whether this is a literal description of the kind of punishment the wicked will receive, or whether it's figurative. Either way, there can be no doubt that God will deal with those who are guilty of wicked and violent behavior in the most severe way. The final verse reveals the righteous will be rewarded by him. The righteous will be rewarded. "For the Lord is righteous, he loves justice. Upright men will see his face." God himself is righteous. And if we are truly committed to him, then our thoughts, words, and actions must be aligned to the godly values we find in the scriptures. We strive to honor God in how we live. We will experience his blessing in this life. But the ultimate reward will be our entrance to heaven, where there we will see the Lord face to face and enjoy his presence forever. So to finish, I want to leave you with two questions. Firstly, what does God see when he looks at your life and mine? As he observes how we deal with times of testing, does he see us trying to cope with those situations in our own strength, or are we like David, trusting God to carry us through? And then finally, where do you stand in relation to the judgment described in this psalm? The Bible clearly states that the wicked will face eternal punishment. Paul, writing to the church in Rome, declared the wages of sin is death. But the good news of the gospel is that we, who are wicked by nature, can be made right with God and count it as righteous in his sight. Paul says in Romans 3, verse 22, that this righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. And we are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. As we prepare to partake in the elements that speak of the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross, so that it could be possible for us to be made right with God, may we do so by faith in the God who can be trusted today, tomorrow, and every day until he calls us home. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we all know what it's like to be tested, and we do struggle. And we confess that we often take our eyes off you and focus on our problem. Forgive us for those times whenever we neglect to consult you. Lord, you watch us constantly, not to catch us out, but you care for us, Lord, so much. And you want nothing more for us to turn to you at those times of need and seek your help and grace. And we thank you for your word today. It reminds us that you can be trusted in every situation. And as we prepare to share in this communion, we thank you that through faith in Jesus, we can be saved. We can be saved for all eternity. And Lord, sometimes we struggle to take that in and understand how that could be. Because deep down we know, Lord, how far we are from you at times. But we thank you, Lord, that whenever we turn to Christ, then we reconnect with you. Because he is the one, the only one, who has bridged the gap between us as sinful people and you as a holy God. So thank you, Lord, that whenever we put our faith in Jesus, we move from death to life. And so we thank you that through Jesus' death on the cross, the fact that he gave up his life, it gave us the opportunity to know new life, everlasting life. And Father, as we continue to live for you in the days to come, may we always be mindful, Lord, that you are with us throughout each day and that you are there to provide us with the help and assistance and resources that we need to cope with the ups and downs of life. Lord, you are that constant presence, and your word tells us that your love will never fail. And so today, as we celebrate communion, we are also reminded of the love you've shown us in Christ. And that love will never end. Father, we praise you and thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. And pray that as we meditate upon what you've been saying today, you will enable us to respond and reach out again to you and know your grace and your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We now share communion together, and all those who love the Lord and seek to live for him are invited to share in this holy meal. As we prepare to share in this sacrament today, let us again hear the words of institution as recorded by the Apostle Paul. I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So we are invited to come and share in this act of remembrance. But as we do, we must heed the apostle's warning. Paul continues, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks of the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." The invitation to share in this holy meal is open to anyone who recognizes their need of the Lord's salvation. Those who have trusted in Jesus as their Lord and Savior are invited to share in the elements today that represent the blood and body of Christ. But before we do, we must be sure to examine ourselves before we come to this table so that we don't eat or drink in an unworthy manner. This is the Lord's table. He invites us to come and share in the feast that he has prepared. But first we must confess our unworthiness and acknowledge our dependence on him. So let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we bow before you, we acknowledge that we have wronged you in many ways through our selfish thoughts, words, and actions. So we come confessing our need of your grace, because there's nothing we can do to make amends for our sin. We can only ask for your forgiveness and trust in your mercy. As we join together to share in this communion, we praise you for the love and grace that sent your Son Jesus Christ into this world. And we thank you that through his death and resurrection, you have made it possible for us to be saved from the punishment we deserve. Forgive us if we have taken such grace for granted and drifted away from you. As we admit our failure to love you and live as we should, assure us of your pardon and restore in us the joy of your salvation, so that we may be renewed in our commitment to live for you. And with that desire to go forward with you, we pray using the words Jesus taught us to use, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As the Lord Jesus, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, so I take these elements of bread and wine to be set apart from all common uses, to this holy use and mystery. And as he gave thanks, we will do likewise by now offering him a prayer of thanksgiving. So let us again pray together. Gracious Father, we praise you for making it possible for us to be part of your family, the church, and for the sense of unity you bring when we trust in Jesus. We thank you for the love and acceptance you have shown through him, and the very real friendship we have with you through all he has done. As we share in this communion, we know that he is here among us to help us and encourage us. And we thank you that as we share this meal, we can experience something of the fullness of life that he promised. As we share in these elements that speak of his sacrificial death, may we be thankful for the new life he offers. And so from this moment, may our commitment to you and your ways be strengthened, so that through our lives, you may be glorified. For it's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. When Jesus had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's join our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time we have shared together in communion with you, and for the reminder of all you were prepared to go through to make us your own. We praise you for what you have accomplished on the cross, for the victory you have won over sin and death, and for your gift of a new life, a life that will continue beyond this one. We can never thank you enough for the sacrifice you've made, but what we can do is show our gratitude through our ongoing commitment to you, your church, and the cause of your kingdom. Lord, through the cross, you have declared your unfailing love for us. So help us, through lives dedicated to you, to declare our love for you and show the world that you are worthy of honor and praise. In these challenging times, may we be the salt and the light the world needs. Make us a blessing to each other and to those in our community who need help and support. As we leave this place of worship today, may we continue to look to you for guidance, and may our lives reflect your great love and demonstrate your amazing grace, so that our homes, places of work, our study, and our community may be transformed by the power of your love. And may you have all the glory, for we ask it in your most powerful and precious name. Amen. We bring our service to a close as we remain seated and sing "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." close with a benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and remain with us always. Amen.